Welcome. I am Adrian K. Wing, Director of the UI Center for Human Rights. I am also the Associate Dean for International and Comparative Law Programs and the Bessie Dutton Murray Professor of Law at the UI College of Law. It is my pleasure to welcome you to the third and final joint event that UICHR, the College of Law, and the College of Public Health are co-sponsoring. These events have been a discussion of Professor Ibram X. Kendi's award-winning book, Stamped from the Beginning, The Definitive History of Racist Ideas in America. Today's presentation covers the last unit in that book entitled Angela Davis, and it focuses on the modern era, the 20th century, later 20th century. Our first event in the series last November featured the Thomas Jefferson unit, and the speaker was University of New Mexico Law Professor Sherry Burr. Her talk was entitled Thomas Jefferson's Paradoxical Relationship with Enslaved and Free Blacks and the Colonization Movement. The second event in the series occurred during Black History Month in February, and that happened to feature me talking about Professor W.E.B. Du Bois and his unit in the book, and my talk was called W.E.B. Du Bois, The Problem of the 21st Century is the Problem of the Color Line. We have had hundreds of people attend this series, probably more than would have ever been able to attend if the events had been live. All of this series is permanently featured on the UICHR website, which is uichr.uiowa.edu. You will find not only the series there, but more than 25 webinars that we have held since going onto Zoom last March. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce my dean, the Dean of the College of Law, Kevin Washburn, who will introduce today's speaker. Dean Washburn has been dean at the college for 3 years. Prior to joining us, he has held many prestigious positions, including being the Assistant Secretary of Indian Affairs during the Obama administration and the Dean of the University of New Mexico Law School. So I turn it over to Dean Washburn.
Thank you, Adrian. Our special guest today is Teri McMurtry Chubb. She is a professor of law at the UIC, the University of Illinois Chicago. She's a law professor there. Her scholarly work is extensive, and I would argue that her impact is also extensive. She is well known and widely admired. She has taught at several law schools. Among her great gifts are writing and advocacy. In her work, she is part literary critic, part social critic, and in her extensive work on race, you can also spy her love of history. She is a pioneer and a very effective advocate for racial justice. She has won a number of awards over the years, national awards. This year, she won the Blackwell Award from the Association of Legal Writing Directors, ALWD, which is the professional organization for legal writing professors. And that award is an award for outstanding career achievements. And I'm proud to say that Professor McMurtry Chubb is not done yet, but she's already won that award. In the great Iowa tradition, she is a wonderful writer, and that makes sense because she is not only alum of our College of Law, but also a graduate of the University of Iowa's History Department. She did graduate work there and has a degree to prove it. She is a person of faith, and if you read her work, you will see that she is a legal scholar of tremendous talent, whose writing is not only thoughtful, but also enjoyable to read. I could probably use up all of her time and still not give her an adequate introduction that meets her incredible worth, but I would rather just let you see her talents for yourself. We are lucky to have her with us today. I am proud to present our alumna, Professor Teri McMurtry Chubb.
Thank you so much, Dean Washburn, for that wonderful introduction. And I'm so excited to be back in one of my formative intellectual homes. And Iowa has meant so much to me, and I'm a proud Iowa alum. So let's get started here. So So what I will be discussing today is the fire this time and the next, the making and sustaining of an activist. And so I really want to center Angela Davis and her work and her formative years and her foundations and her continued work in this presentation. So Angela Davis grew up in Birmingham, Alabama, to activist parents, Sally and B. Frank Davis. She grew up experiencing the effects of poverty in her community. She would, as she was going through the school system, which was segregated at the time because her parents were of a slightly higher socioeconomic level, she recalls being during the lunch period with students who didn't have, you know, food to eat and sharing her food with them as her mother had shown by example. But in her experiences as a young child, she recalls thinking, I would never, and I was categorical about this, never harbor or express the desire to be white. She grew up in a place called Dynamite Hill, so named because of the threat of bombings by the KKK, the Ku Klux Klan. In 1959, at the age of 15, she went to Manhattan to attend an integrated high school. And by 1959, this is important, Alabama's schools had yet to be integrated. So we kind of think of, oh, you know, Brown v. Board of Education, 1954, integrated everything, but it did not. And Southern states were very slow, and some would argue if they have adhered to integration at all. In fact, if you read the brilliant work of another Iowa native, Nicole Hannah Jones, who writes for the New York Times and of course is the originator of the 1619 Project. Nicole Hannah Jones came to national prominence by talking about school segregation and school desegregation. And she argues in her work that in the United States, we reached a critical tipping point probably in the 1980s with respect to integration and then have been moving backwards ever since. So Angela Davis at 15 goes off to Manhattan to attend the integrated high school. And from there, she attends Brandeis University 2 years later. But she became disillusioned with white activists on her campus and sought other ways to learn and nurture her activism. In the summer of 1962, she attended the 8th World Festival of Youth and Students in Helsinki, Finland, organized by the World Federation of Democratic Youth. So I mention this because this is going to be, again, one of those through lines through Angela Davis's career, that she is looking always to make the world a better place around her, but searching for a theoretical framework in order to do so, one that kind of captures what is her vision and what's in her imagination. So this was the badge. On this slide, I've included the badge from this 8th World Festival of Youth and Students. This festival hosted 18,000 participants from 137 countries under the theme for peace and friendship. In that year, the festival welcomed a large delegate of US citizens. The event, which was Soviet sponsored, has been described by scholars as the battlefront in the cultural Cold War. So you have to imagine, you have this youth conference in 1962, 18,000 participants, many of them from the United States, and it's kind of the site of the cultural Cold War, and who will win in their creating of the narrative around this event. And the 1962 event is significant also because it occurred after the Berlin Crisis in 1961. But before the Cuban Missile Crisis in October of 1962. Intelligence reports from the festival reveal significant KGB and CIA influence behind the scenes. And so when I was doing research about this event and looking at the scholarly work on it, it was kind of fascinating to me, and I kind of got a chill because you will see this kind of echoes in what will become a defining moment in Angela Davis's activism. So back at Davis after this youth festival, back at Brandeis, excuse me, Davis attended James Baldwin's on-campus talk in October of 1962 about his forthcoming book, The Fire Next Time. This event coincided with the Cuban Missile Crisis. And by the time Baldwin had come to Brandeis, He had already written Notes of a Native Son, which are his collective essays, and emigrated to Paris in an escape from American racism. But more than that, he wished to be someplace where he could think, write, and just be without the burden of segregation and the threat of racial violence. The Fire Next Time was to be a criticism, a critique, as only Baldwin can do it, on the assimilationist politics of the civil rights movement. And so one of the things that he writes in the book is, do I really want to be integrated into a burning house, right? So this is a very provocative question. You have to kind of think about this in the context of in which he's giving it, right? He doesn't yet know when he comes on the campus for this talk that we're going to be in the middle of the Cuban Missile Crisis, but quickly, of course, in the James Baldwin tradition, organizes an anti-war protest on the spot. But in the book, he says, do I really want to be integrated into a burning house? And he also writes, white Americans find it as difficult as white people elsewhere do to divest themselves of the notion that they are in possession of some intrinsic value that Black people need or want. And this assumption, which, for example, makes the solution to the Negro problem depend on the speed with which Negroes accept and adopt white standards, is revealed in all kinds of striking ways. From Bobby Kennedy's assurance that a Negro can become president in 40 years, to the unfortunate tone of warm congratulation to which so many liberals address their Negro equals. It is the Negro, of course, who is presumed to have become equal, an achievement that not only proves the comforting fact that perseverance has no color, but also overwhelmingly corroborates the white man's sense of his own value. Alas, this value can scarcely be corroborated in any other way. There is certainly little enough in the white man's public or private life that one should desire to imitate. White men at the bottom of their hearts know this. So imagine being a young person in college, fresh from this Helsinki World Youth Festival, listening to the great James Baldwin, and in the middle of his talk about this book, the Cuban Missile Crisis happening, and then he just on the fly organizes an anti-war protest. So this really had an impact on young Angela. So she's in the process of putting together, at this very dynamic time in our nation's history, developing a theoretical frame for activism. At Brandeis, she meets the wonderful Herbert Mark Hughes, who was steeped in the Frankfurt School of the Institute for Social Research. And she subsequently went to France to study with Mark Hughes, who becomes her scholar, her scholarly template, if you will, and her mentor. And the Frankfurt School had a profound influence on the development of philosophy, social, and political theory, particularly in the United States and also worldwide. At the time Davis studied with Mark Hughes, he was a renowned social theorist and philosopher. One of the things that he has written in his writings, and this is again something that continually pops up in Mark Hughes's work, and that no doubt Angela would have heard, that radical action is needed to overcome the oppressive, repressive, and reified structure of advanced industrial society. So again, Mark Hughes is urging Davis and others to take a bird's eye view and to look at structures and systems and not people, particularly to look at the plight of workers and working class people internationally. And this is going to be an important part of Angela Davis's work. But just like James Baldwin in his immigration to France, Angela Davis is both torn between her budding development of a theoretical frame for her activist work and what's going on stateside. Again, she's from Birmingham, and a lot is going on in Birmingham in 1963. These particular events pulled her back into Birmingham life, both in her headspace and physically. So in 1963, when Angela Davis was 19 and studying with Mark Hughes in France, she hears of this horrific bombing. On Sunday, September 15th, 1963, Addie Mae Collins, age 14, Denise McNair, age 11, Carol Robertson, age 14, and Cynthia Wellesley, 14, were killed by a bomb that had been placed under the stairs of the church by members of the Ku Klux Klan. And you can see them all in this newspaper article. And I picked this picture because it shows you just how young these girls were. The bombing was one of three that occurred in 11 days following the federal order to desegregate Alabama public schools. So imagine, and I think it's kind of lost on us these days, particularly for those of us who didn't live, who weren't alive during this era, but that there were bombings as a result of attempts to enforce Brown v. Board, of attempts to integrate the schools. And these little girls were the casualties of that war for integration. Upwards of 20 church members were injured in the bombing. When protesters gathered at the church, which was a crime scene, and a horrific crime scene at that, Angela Davis described, she knew all of the girls who were the victims of the bombing, except for Addie Mae Collins. And her mother was a school teacher and had taught these girls. And so she just, you know, this was very personal for her. But she describes her mother taking Carol's mother over to the church, which at the time, Carol's mother believed she was going to pick up Carol. And what they're greeted with there is this bombing scene where there are body parts all over the church. This was dynamite that was placed underneath the stairs of the basement. And so just these images, if you can think about it, like these traumatic images that are burned into her mind, her mother recounting these things, and then the people of Birmingham showing up at this church to protest what had happened. And so upwards of 20 church members were also injured in the bombing. This is important. When protesters gathered at the church, then Governor George Wallace sent hundreds of police and state troopers to stop them. Two Black boys, Johnny Robertson and Virgil Ware, were killed by the mob and the police that were sent to stop them. Johnny was shot by police for allegedly throwing stones at moving cars. Virgil, who was on a bicycle at the time of his death, was shot by a white man on a motor scooter. So now Angela Davis, she's in France, she comes back, she graduates from Brandeis, and she's going to Germany to begin her graduate studies with Herbert Mark Hughes in philosophy. But she's moving to putting theory together with practice to form praxis, and her activism is moving from SNCC and then evolving into Black Power. So again, this theoretical framework that she's developing is pushing her toward a more comprehensive understanding of multiple interlocking oppressions. So looking at structural inequality versus individual acts of meanness or individual acts of racism. And so she also is learning from an increasingly revolutionary MLK before his death. MLK says, power is not the white man's birthright. It will not be legislated for us and delivered in neat government packages. And also reinforcing that the police are the armed guardians of the social order. This is Eldridge Cleaver, one of the founders of the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense, the Minister of Information. The Blacks are the chief domestic victims of the social order. A conflict of interest exists, therefore, between the Blacks and the police. So what you're seeing here is, again, this growing discontent, the spotlight being placed on structural issues that prove as barriers to Black life in the United States. I also want to emphasize that the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense was steeped in the theory of post-colonialism or neocolonialism, post-colonialism, anti-colonialism. They were reading Frantz Fanon. They were influenced by Che Guevara and Patrice Lumumba. And, you know, looking at their 10-point program, you can see many of the things that resonate with us today. We want freedom. We want power to determine the destiny of our Black community. We want full employment for our people. We want an end to the robbery by the white man of our Black community. We want decent housing fit for shelter of human beings. We want education for our people that exposes the true nature of this decadent American society. We want education that teaches us our true history and our role in the present day society. So you'll see that these points could have been written today. They could have been written yesterday. They still resonate and are still at the forefront of the movement for Black lives in this country. So Angela moves to communism. The Communist Party of the United States, the Che Lumumba Club, named for Che Guevara and Patrice Lumumba. This was a space for her to envision and conceptualize a larger scope for the struggle for equity, to articulate social ills as embedded in patriarchy, capitalism, imperialism, and white supremacy. The Che Lumumba Club, which is a person of color youth club within the Communist Party of the USA, was named for the revolutionary, of course, Che Guevara and Patrice Lumumba. And Patrice Lumumba was the first prime minister of the Independent Democratic Republic of Congo. And because she had a commitment, remember Herbert Marcuse's influence, right? And kind of conceptualizing the plight of the poor and working person, working class person worldwide, but primarily in the United States, the Communist Party had a commitment to organizing, labor organizing. And it was a movement of poor and working class Black people as well. So I put Robin, the incomparable Robin D.G. Kelly's history of Alabama communists during the Great Depression, Black Alabama communists during the Great Depression. Also because we're at a moment presently where I believe it was yesterday that the workers in the Bessemer Amazon plant were voting on whether to unionize. So this is something that is deep in Southern Black labor politics. I want you to understand that the Communist Party is not new to Black people and Black people are not new to the Communist Party. And Angela Davis finds a home here, a home that will later be the subject of her greatest targeting by the American government. The making of an activist icon. So the FBI under the directorship of J. Edgar Hoover declared war on the Black Panther Party. After learning of Angela Davis's communist and activist activities, Ronald Reagan, who was then the governor of California, fired Davis from her teaching position at UCLA, which was later reinstated by court order. Reagan, Hoover, and President Richard Nixon then focused all of the power of the state on Davis as she and her fellow Che Lumumba Club members worked to free the Soledad brothers, George Jackson, John Clouchette, and Fleeta Drumgo, from prison on charges of murder of a prison guard. In August of 1970, Jackson's younger brother Joshua held a judge, prosecutor, and jurors from a courtroom in Marin County, California hostage and died in a subsequent shootout with the police. One of the guns that he used was traced to Davis. Davis, it was no secret that she had guns. In fact, she was raised in a household with guns because she grew up in a place called Dynamite Hill in a city called Birmingham, but known during the civil rights movement as Bombingham. So her father always had guns at the ready to protect the family from racist violence, particularly violence by the KKK and racist mobs. So, seizing upon this information, Reagan, Hoover, and Nixon, who Davis calls the unholy trinity, seized on the opportunity to charge Davis with murder, kidnapping, and conspiracy. She fled in defense of her life, was caught in October of 1970, and subsequently tried and acquitted following a massive movement to free Angela Davis and all political prisoners. So this is when Angela Davis becomes, you know, we have those enduring images of her with her natural hair in splendor and her fist raised, a stance that we in the movement adopt to this day. And this became iconic. This is what she is best known for. But Angela Davis continues to speak out against multiple interlocking forms of oppression: capitalism, imperialism, white supremacy, and patriarchy. Most current is her work in prison abolition. And so I'm gonna take a page from the Angela Davis playbook. She influences me in many things. And I would be remiss if I didn't take this time to talk to you about our prisons obsolete. So in about 3 or 4 minutes, I'm going to make the case for abolition, as Angela Davis would want me to do. So as Dean Washburn mentioned, I received a wonderful education at our University of Iowa Department of History. I am a 19th century social and legal historian, and my focus is the plantation. Also, at the time I was in the department, we were having Che Guevara t-shirt parties and Hammer and Hoe birthday parties. And so this is a topic that is very near and dear to my heart. And so I want to talk to you about why we should think seriously about prison abolition. So the most enduring and vexing image of the plantation is Tara from Gone with the Wind. You'll see this picture I've included of Scarlett O'Hara running out of Tara with her skirts flying. In actuality, the plantation was a forced labor camp. The plantation economy, the precursor to our modern economy, was built on the U.S. dominance of the global cotton market from the early 18-teens until about 1860. This billion-dollar economy was made possible by the forced labor and torture of enslaved Africans. Walter Johnson tells us in his River of Dark Dreams of the enslaved recollections of their torture. He writes, 15 lashes, 30 lashes, 200, 400. So severely that the fibers of my shirt healed fast to my back, until my clothes were so full of blood that flowed from my own body. Until the blood ran out of his shoes, so that he was out of work for 10 days, 2 weeks before he could walk, so that he was always subject to fits after that, so that no pen can ever describe what my feelings were, so that language itself collapsed under the onslaught. So I just want to take the time to draw some parallels here to the plantation and to our present prison system. So surveillance was a key part of the plantation life for the enslaved. For example, statutes in Alabama and Mississippi prohibited the enslaved from hiring themselves out, being in spaces at planter or overseer houses for more than a specified number of hours and without planter or overseer permission, gathering in groups on plantations other than their own, except to attend church services, funerals, or otherwise permitted by planters and overseers, and leaving plantations without a pass. A white man's presence was required at all times in the presence of 6 or more enslaved persons. For infractions, enslaved persons were whipped and planters were fined. The authority to surveil was transferred to overseers by law and by the terms of statutes and their own employment contracts with planters. By 1860, there were 38,000 overseers employed on southern antebellum plantations. Overseers were the first managerial class of workers in the United States. And so when I don't say that lightly, so I want you to think about, are there times where I felt surveilled at work? What are some tactics that employers use to keep workers in line? And you'll start to get an idea about the impact of overseer and plantation management on managerial identity in the US. Fast forward to the roots of management in the prison system and surveillance. And there is this software that I've mentioned here, Offender 360 and Youth 360, is a prison surveillance software that is hosted by Microsoft, and it's a cloud-based surveillance system. And it was launched in the Illinois Department of Corrections in 2009. At that time, there were 49,000 offenders in IDOC custody, 28,000 parolees across 28 facilities, and Offender 360 centralized all of this information. So it was able to track inmates, and it basically, you know, it identifies them by attributes such as scars, marks, tattoos. It categorizes people according to their threat and aggression level, and allows prison guards to make ad hoc queries that can basically track individual or groups according to religion, aggression level, threat level, and markings on their bodies. So I want you to just think about that for a moment and the parallels with the Plantation South. Blueprints. So by now, most of us know the text of the 13th Amendment that I've placed here. And its exception. Georgia was, the state of Georgia seized on this exception and became a model in how to develop its prison systems in a manner that recaptured its formerly enslaved persons. So 2 years after the passage of the 13th Amendment in its 1867 code, the criminal code, the Georgia legislature allowed overseers and guards to supervise convicts, both men and women, on chain gangs. By 1895, it had expanded that role. Fast forward to today, I was just Googling and seeing, okay, if I wanted to become a prison guard, like what, how would I do that? And you know, Google answered, as it always does. And so it describes guards as following. Prison guards are responsible for enforcing rules preventing assaults and escapes and maintaining the general order of the facilities to which they are assigned. Guards respond to emergency situations such as riots, fires, and confrontation. More specific responsibilities often depend on the prison guard's assignment. It can include contraband searches, control and transport of inmates, inmate conduct and reporting, like using the software I mentioned, and providing discipline as needed, and inspecting incoming mail and visitors. So this is the work that Angela Davis continues to do and is influencing a new generation of prison abolitionists, among them Miriam Kaba, who just wrote a brilliant book, We Do This Till We Free Us, on the roots of abolition, prison abolition, and the ongoing struggle to push people to reimagine a world without incarceration and a different model of a different model for accountability. The picture that I showed you with Angela Davis next to the book, Are Prisons Obsolete, are actually of Davis in solitary confinement. And so she was in solitary confinement up to the point of her trial. So this is something, of course, that is really integral to her activism and work internationally at this time. The last thing I wanna talk about is the sustaining of an activist and trauma. So racism is linked to negative health outcomes among people of color, particularly Black people. And so cortisol, epinephrine, and adrenaline are needed to deal with racial discrimination and violence. And the release of these chemicals into the body lead to high blood pressure, heart disease, sleeplessness, restlessness. There are also studies like in Joy DeGruy's post-traumatic slave syndrome and Resma Menachem's My Grandmother's Hands that talk about trauma as it imprints itself in one's DNA. It changes us and it is passed down through generation to generation to generation in our bodies. And our bodies know what our minds can't automatically articulate. So I want you to think about, you know, and Angela Davis has, you know, she doesn't like to talk about her time in prison, obviously, or the trauma that she saw, but she does mention it as trauma. And it's important to recognize the effects of racial discrimination, even microaggressions, and seeing the murders of people at the hands of police, or just witnessing that as a bystander through social media or otherwise, is traumatic. The discussions we have in our classrooms, if not handled with care and don't take into account trauma, can re-traumatize students of color. So I'll leave us with that, and hopefully we can have a robust discussion in the time that we have left. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor McMurtry Chubb, for a wonderful presentation, much rich food for thought. So audience, we have about 10 minutes or so, no, 15 minutes maybe or so for questions. So please put them in the Q&A. I already have something to ask. In the beginning of your talk, you mentioned James Baldwin wondering if, you know, he should try to integrate into a burning house. Do you feel, you personally feel that are we in a burning house, a burnt down house? Are we in a situation in America where, you know, we need to use the master's tools and the famous words of Audre Lorde, you know, and figure out what to do inside of the house? Where are we overall?
Well, James Baldwin and James Baldwin's brilliant fashion poses the question, right? He lets us decide. So his question is, do I really want to be integrated into a burning house? I think there's no debate that the house is indeed burning. And the question is, do we want a seat at the table or do we want to let the house burn down? And this is the enduring question. Do you work within this system to create and move the needle further, which is what diversity, equity, inclusion efforts are designed to do? Or do we just reimagine a different kind of house, which is what anti-racist efforts are meant to do? So I think that we need to, as my dad would say, need to allow people to get in where they fit in. That there are some who are not ready to kind of really reckon and grapple with the settler colonialist violence of the academy, if you will, or our other institutions, and are kind of okay with the way things are, but would just like them to be more inclusive and to push the needle that so that everyone can have the same opportunities within them. And there are those of us, and I count myself among them, that really want to imagine a different house and a different table with different seats. But I think that the latter is much more difficult, in the same way as there's tons of pushback when one wants to talk about abolition, or tons of pushback when one wants to push us all to reimagine different things, because it's scary and it's unknown. And so I would say that I'm in the latter camp. I don't poo-poo the former camp. And I think there's a place for all of us, but I think that we really need to think about why we keep going in the door of a house that continues to do us violence.
Thank you. Question, can you perhaps talk about Truth and Reconciliation Commission efforts as they are applied in the US? You may or may not be aware that Iowa City attempted to start a TRC to deal with issues, you know, relating to this area. And the efforts, of course, came after Black Lives Matters and other, you know, local events, and people started resigning and everything's in a flux. Do you have information about some of the efforts that other communities are doing? You have any thoughts for Iowa City and what they maybe should think about doing if they're going to be able to actually move forward in a serious way with this?
Yeah, so that's a wonderful question. There's a wonderful young scholar. Her name is Kelly Bogile Zabgo, and she is she did her dissertation on truth and reconciliation in the United States, and has been helping with certain efforts in different states. I think that it's difficult. One, because I think there's a reluctance on behalf of people who have been harmed to speak it in arenas that, or areas that may not be welcoming to hearing it. It's kind of a re-traumatization, if you will. Like, we can talk about it with our people, but to talk about it in kind of like a hearing where we're collecting information, that is difficult. And it is also difficult to genuinely assess if there are people who are willing to hear it, not just as voyeurs, but to hear it and then to act positively on the information. And so there are also stages to it where there is a hearing process that needs to be caringly and lovingly shepherded through. There needs to be multiple kinds of professionals there, historians, lawyers, psychiatrists to help and who are skilled in, you know, and who understand interlocking systems of oppression to lead people through it. But there also has to be a willingness not only to just listen, but to do something about it. And so I think that's where the discontent comes from. And if I'm going to tell you my story and it's going to take something from me to tell you how the institution that I was in did me some harm, then I need you then to act on that information in a way that's going to fix it, not just say, thank you for your story. And so I think that's kind of where we get hung up. And I think that's where the frustration happens. But I think it is necessary that institutions hear and bear witness to the harm that the people in them, and they center that harm in trying to come up with solutions, that it's not just kind of top-down theorizing about, oh, well, what do the people in this institution need? They will tell you if you ask them. I guarantee you, at any institution, the people who are marginalized in that institution can tell you what is happening, but they're not telling you because they either don't think you're gonna listen or it's gonna cost them too much to go out on a limb and do that.
Thank you. And for those who are interested in the use of these TRCs abroad, you should definitely look at the South African experience. I was involved in that time period in South Africa, and there were many people against it and many people for it. And it's been 20 years and many people are still frustrated at what happened or what didn't happen. So thank you for your thoughts on our national experience. Another question, could you speak to how you see and use both history and law as tools for anti-racist activism?
That's a great question. So I think, you know, it was really funny when I entered graduate school, like, you know, before I entered graduate school, I would tell my professors, I would say, hey, I want to, you know, go to law school, but I also want to do history. And it was mind boggling to me that they would say to me, I don't really see a connection between the two. And I would say, what? I don't not see a connection between the two. Are you kidding me? So for me, they've never been separate. And I think that we need to contextualize struggle, and we need to contextualize most importantly, we need to develop broad theoretical frameworks so that we can begin to think about how we might make change within certain structures and systems. And so for me, you know, history is integral to my understanding of the law, and the law helps me understand how the law operates in a practical way, either in total ignorance of history or with blind hubris in the face of it. And so I think that, you know, both of them are necessary. And so I use them in, you know, when I was practicing law full time, and first as a law clerk and then as an associate, both my judges and the people that worked in my law firm would laugh at me because they'd say, okay, you are contextualizing what the law is for these judges. And I said, yes, I'm teaching them. They need to understand, right? And I've never, to this day, I have never lost a motion that I have filed ever. And so judges appreciate that. And they also appreciate an understanding. And also they can't say they didn't know, right? but I think that it is important that we always go forward with an understanding of how the law uses history, sometimes in very bad ways, but also contextualizing historically. I just had our International Human Rights Clinic at the UIC Law School. They were talking about surveillance, and they were like all up in arms. They're like, oh, this new surveillance tactics that are coming out against Black Lives Matter. And I said, whoa, have you heard of COINTELPRO? And before that, have you heard of the plantation laws? And so I spent, you know, about an hour and a half on a Zoom call with the students who are working on those cases to give them some context. And they were like, oh, wow, like we had no idea this went so deep. But it's important for them to understand also so they can study tactics and develop strategies.
Mm-hmm. And also, you know, the value of movies that come out. So the recent movie about Judas and the Black Messiah, you know, which got different awards for different actors and so forth. I mean, it brought to life the Countel Pro and everything that was going on that I lived through, but that, you know, many people today weren't alive, never even heard of it. So the important role of the film industry when it can be positive is important.
And the movie on King too, King and the FBI.
Oh, yes, yes.
The documentary, yeah.
Exactly. Yeah, that the documentary. There's so many things that are on all of the different, you know, cable and other services that you can purchase that are so important. So someone said, could you repeat the name of the individual related to the TRC work? I'm not sure if it can be typed into the Q&A, if people will see that, or if you can just, you know, slowly spell it. Maybe slowly spell it as well. I know they can't see the chat, but I'm
yeah,
not
let sure. me, I want to make sure. Her name is Kelly Bokile.
Mm-hmm.
But let me make sure I get the proper spelling here.
Yeah, it's very musical, but yes. It's how it sounds, but not easy to
yeah, know. So Kelly Bogile is K-E-L-E B-O-G-I-L-E. And her last name is Zwabgo. Z-V-O-B-G-O. And so one of the key articles that she wrote is called Designing Truth, Facilitating Perpetrator Testimony at Truth Commissions.
Wonderful. Very good. Somebody is bringing back this metaphor of the house. Does it work better to destroy the house from the inside, put the fire out from the outside, or add more fuel to the flames from the outside?
Well, I think working, I think we, most of us have really grand ideas about our own personal metal when working in the house. And we don't understand the power of the house to co-opt us. It is so easy for institutions to co-opt us in various ways. They are very good. In fact, it is a key colonial strategy to recruit people who look like the people who you're oppressing to rule over them. and so this is a strategy that has been winning since colonialism in African countries to enslavement, right? When you think of the slave drivers on plantations, slave drivers were from the ranks of the enslaved, distinguishable from overseers who were white men hired on plantations. So it is difficult to, you know, be kind of like that mole in the house who, you know, is silently lighting those fires. And the great personal cost is huge if one is caught, and the punishment is swift and harrowing. Throwing fuel and fire outside of the house, and doing the things that you do. I think, you know, I'm a big believer in purpose and faith, as Dean Washburn said. So I think we all have a purpose. And we're all here to live out our purpose and to do the things that we were put here to do. And so if we just keep doing that, and if we ask ourselves the questions of why am I doing it and for what purpose I'm doing it, hopefully it's for a reason external to yourself, then I think we will all be able to make the change that we need to make, regardless of whether we're in the house or outside of it. We all have a role to play and we all have a purpose to serve.
Okay, going back to your argument about abolishing prisons, we know the history is awful, we know there's a lot of racism, etc. But what about the fact that, you know, shouldn't murderous police go to prison? It was just revealed in, you know, the man who killed, you know, the 8 people, including the 6 Asian women, and said, oh, it wasn't, you know, I wasn't focusing on their race. We just heard Yesterday, a man attacked a woman on the street right in Manhattan in New York and stomped on her. And it turns out he had been in prison for murder of his mother. And he had been let out and was living in a homeless shelter nearby. I mean, should that type of, I mean, isn't there, aren't there some people that need to be locked up for long periods of time, even though many of the people who are in prison, you know, often have mental health issues, drug issues, and other issues that maybe should also be being addressed, you know, from a medical perspective as well?
So I'll use Angela Davis's words to answer that question. She spoke at the University of Chicago a while ago, and what she said was this: the chain of the feminist movement, the personal is the political, is particularly significant when talking about prisons. That how we seek justice in our personal relationships is influenced by how the state models for us how that justice should be meted out. And it's, we talk about it in violent terms. So we talk about it as, if this person does something to me, I'm going to get them back, right? And so we speak about it as, well, this person did something, so they need to be what? Like, what is caging a person really at the end of the day? What kind of justice is that? So as an abolitionist, one of my goals is to urge us to rethink accountability. It's not saying that people shouldn't be held accountable for the acts that they do, but it's not modeling that accountability on a structure that was never meant for accountability to begin with. It wasn't. And so if you're going to reimagine how we hold people accountable, you know, I will throw questions back at you like, so does that mean that we need to torture a person in prison? Because solitary confinement is inhumane. Does it mean that we just make them have, you know, what, we allow them to have 1 hour of light in their prison cell or 1 hour of exercise for the entire day or, you know, a week, however often it is, for the term of their lives? Like the wonderful activist Mariam Kaba urges us to do, I would urge you to build relationships with incarcerated individuals, to actually speak with them, put money on their commissary funds. There are letter writing campaigns for incarcerated individuals, and I can send links to those that Dean Wing can post you know, with this video. So it is kind of, again, not just saying people should be able to do whatever they want to do. It's reconceptualizing accountability and understanding that the prison system in its current, the carceral state, the industrial complex, is built on capitalist, imperialist, patriarchal, and white supremacist norms that should have no place in a humanitarian, just, and equitable society.
Thank you. There's 2 minutes left. It was more time than I had said initially, but there's 2 minutes left. There's many questions that I can't get to, but one I thought would be good to end with. 2 minutes left for you, and then I'm going to have a brief closing remark. Someone is talking about burnout. You know, when you're in these struggles and you're an activist and, you know, people get burned out. Do you have any suggestions that you can give in, you know, a very succinct fashion concerning what do we do when we get burned out, when people around us get burned out to renew ourselves or get additional support?
Yeah, my personal motto is when I say yes to one thing, there's something else that I have to say no to. And I can't be in the habit, and you can't be in the habit of constantly saying no to yourself. And so you have to really think through, what am I doing? Is it adding to my purpose? Is it adding value? Can someone else do this? Part of the way you develop networks and mentor successfully is to say, you know what? I have this on my plate and I know someone else who can do it. Let them do it, right? Because it's about the work. It's not about the individual. So I would just say, be, discard your schedule, and your purpose will focus you. If those things that you're saying to you are outside of your purpose, they're not going to add value. They're not something that is in your lane. Give it to someone else, or politely say no, because you can say no at the outset. It's kind of hard to say no once you're in the middle of it, right?
Thank you so much, Professor. We only have a few minutes left to conclude. I would like to once again thank the College of Law and the College of Public Health for co-sponsoring this wonderful series with UICHR. And of course, I have to thank my wonderful former student, Teri McMurtry Chubb, for Zooming in from Chicago to share her thoughts with us. I'm now going to close with just mentioning a few upcoming events. Some of which are you can see there, not there, is on Monday, April 5th, there will be a presentation about the Biden administration and the State Department Bureau of Democracy, Human Rights, and Labor. On the 7th of April, you can see there at noon, we're going to have a panel on renewing a human rights agenda, the climate crisis. And then on April 28th, we are going to have a panel on Native American rights. Great programming is only possible with your assistance and support. We hope you've enjoyed today's event and you will consider supporting us in the future. Going to our website, you will see a link where you can support us. We all hope that you will have a good rest of the day, a good rest of the week. And thank you all once again. Good afternoon.